Hello, everyone. You're listening to Family Talk, the radio broadcasting ministry of the James Dobson Family Institute. I'm Dr. James Dobson, and thank you for joining us for this program.
Welcome to Dr. James Dobson's Family Talk. I'm Roger Marsh, thanking you for joining us and thanking you for making us a part of your day. Family Talk is only possible because of you. It's because of your prayers and generosity that we remain on the air. Remember that if you like what you hear each day, please tell a friend. And also be sure to include the call letters of the station you listen to this program on. Your local station is incredibly important to ensuring that biblical truth is heard in the public square. Well, today you are going to hear the rock-solid, powerful words taken from an important and enlightening presentation given by our guest speaker here on Family Talk. His name is U.S. Army Lieutenant General Jerry Boykin. He recently retired after a 36-year military career. He's a highly decorated American freedom fighter, a culture warrior, and a longtime friend of our ministry. Recently, he gave a presentation to a group assembled by Dr. Dobson on the subject of restoring our military to greatness. General Boykin believes that the Pentagon and many of its leaders have become wokeified, if you will, in this day of political correctness. That needs to change or dire consequences will ensue. As we commemorate Veterans Day today, you're about to hear the general's presentation and summation with a battle cry to restore our military to greatness. And by the way, be sure to thank a veteran today or this weekend, won't you? Now, a bit about Lieutenant General Jerry Boykin before we begin our program. General Boykin serves as the Executive Vice President at the Family Research Council in Washington, D.C., and was one of the original members of the U.S. Army's Delta Force. He went on to command these elite warriors in combat operations. Later on in his career with the Army, he also led the Green Berets as well as the Special Warfare Center and school. During his 36-year military career, General Boykin was involved in numerous high-profile missions, including the 1980 Iran hostage rescue attempt, the 1992 hunt for Pablo Escobar in Colombia, and the Black Hawk Down incident in Mogadishu, Somalia. General Boykin is an ordained minister with a passion for the gospel of Jesus Christ, and he encourages Christians to become warriors in God's kingdom. He served his last 4 years of public service as the Deputy Undersecretary of Defense for Intelligence under President George W. Bush. That took place from 2002 to 2007. General Boykin and his wife Ashley are the parents of 5 children and numerous grandchildren. Well, General Boykin delivers a sense of moral righteousness and biblical truth to get his message across, to make clear that our troops are ill-equipped to defend us on foreign soil because of radical policies and misguided agendas. Sadly, the many young men and women who enlist in our military are often lost from the get-go because of the indoctrination they received as children and teens. Well, there's so much to learn, so let's not waste another moment further. And remember, part one of this presentation is already up on our website, drjamesdobson.org/family talk. Here now once again is Lieutenant General Jerry Boykin with part two of his powerful presentation on today's edition of Family Talk.
Today's military diversity does not apply only to race. It also applies to sexual and gender preferences. President Biden issued an order, Executive Order 14004, allowing transgenders to serve in the Army. And as I said, that probably was within the 48 hours after he took over that he lifted that ban on transgenders. But you know what? In case you don't realize it, you're paying for their surgery. You're paying for their hormone therapy. Taxpayers are paying for that. But, you know, it gets worse. It's not just that we're paying for it. It is also that they get the first 18 to 24 months that they're in the military to go through the surgery and recover, do their rehab before they're even deployable. So we're bringing people in that we're going to pay for their surgery and their hormones and then give them 24 months to go through this. And if you want to know what it's costing over a 10-year period, $3.7 billion. And we did the math on this at Family Research Council and figured this out and passed it over to the Pentagon and said, do you really want to do this? Well, it made a difference when President Trump was there. Of course, as soon as he left, nobody paid any attention to this. $3.7 billion. You know what we could do with $3.7 billion? With our troops that are under-equipped now that they've had 20 years in Afghanistan, you know what we could do with $3.7 billion? It would help a lot. We're wasting our time and our money, but more importantly, we're wasting the time of those young men and women that are going to have to fight the nation's wars with this kind of nonsense. This is what's happening in our Pentagon today. They're teaching us not to be men is a statement that one of the West Pointers that has been through all of this came out with this statement. He said, they're teaching us how not to be men. Department of Defense education. I guess most of you realize that the Department of Defense actually has its own school system, a public school system, most of the time for K through 12th grade. They've got 160 schools serving 69,000 children and military personnel, and they've got a budget of $3.2 billion. Now, this is the children of our warriors that are putting their lives on the line. They're in these school systems in many places, particularly overseas, in Europe or Asia, any of those places overseas. They have to go to school here because they don't have other schools for them. They're now peddling the CRT, white shaming, and left-wing activism to the pupils K through 12. How about recruiting and retention? Recruiting and retention, that's how we build a military. All branches are struggling to retain and recruit new personnel, all branches. In fact, the Secretary of the Army, Christine Wormuth, says, this has been the most challenging recruiting year since the creation of the volunteer force. And they can't figure out why they can't recruit. I can help them. I can be a huge help to them if they listen. You're not going to attract people into the military with nonsense like what you're doing to the ones that are already there. And by the way, you're not going to retain the ones that are there for exactly the same reason. So look at this. This year, the Army missed its recruiting goal by 15,000, and that's just the Army. All of them missed their recruiting goals, and they can't figure out why they're not recruiting. But the president's got a good answer for it. It's the economy is so good that it's hard to get them to come into the military now because our economy is doing so well. That is one of those, what do you say, don't believe your lying eyes, just believe what I tell you. 25% shortfall in recruiting for the Army alone. And the recruiting environment is so tough that the Army is offering bonuses of $50,000 for people that will come into the military, enlisted in the military. I don't know if it's a 3 or 4 year commitment. $50,000, I've never heard of anything like that. But they can't figure out why they can't recruit the people that they need to maintain their force structure. You probably realize this, but 77% of all Americans between the age of 17 and 35 cannot qualify to enlist in our military without a waiver. You realize that? Only 23% of the population, 17 to 35, can actually qualify without some kind of waiver. Realize that? You know what the problem is? Number one problem, obesity. Diabetes, which often goes hand in hand with obesity. Poor physical fitness, felony charges. History of drug abuse, failure to graduate from high school. Those are all things that require a waiver to be able to come into the military. But the standards have been reduced in order to allow women in frontline combat units. Multiple failures of the physical test may not be disqualifying. You can fail the physical test and still stay in the military. Go to the COVID vaccine. Retention is suffering due to the mandated COVID-19 vaccine. You've seen a lot of this, a lot of information about this on television. And religious exemptions are not approved. As of February 2022, 25,000 service members had requested religious accommodations. Less than 10% have been approved. And listen carefully. The 10% that's been approved are people that were already processing out of the military. And they call it a religious exemption because for one reason or another, they're already leaving. They've decided to leave the military. They're being thrown out for another reason, but they're given a religious exemption. 0% approval in the Army and the Navy. Not one religious exemption in the Army and Navy. Not one. Think about that. You know, I was talking earlier about how there's persecution against Christians. They want us to be the terrorist. They want us to be the insurrectionist. U.S. Coast Guard Academy just expelled 7 minority seniors that actually graduated from the Coast Guard Academy, and the Coast Guard Academy threw them out a week before graduation. According to one court, the Air Force has processed to protect religious rights is both illusory and insincere. In short, it's just theater. That's coming from the court. But what can you have and still be qualified to be in the military? Well, look at this. You cannot disqualify a person that is going through gender transition or HIV positive. Now, how many of you have ever been in the military? Anybody ever been in the infantry? You know, there's this thing in the infantry that you train people in a hot combat. You train people to take blood from one arm and put it directly into a dying man's arm. Now we're letting people with HIV positive serve in our military. And if they have a medical exemption, they can stay in the military. But they cannot remain in the military if they have a religious objection to COVID. I'm going to go to something that I think demonstrates very well the situation and the conditions of our military. Military members are being bullied, by the way. And they're being bullied by their chain of command. And you know what that's going to do? That's going to create another generation of Americans that want nothing to do with our military. Because these people are being bullied and forced out of the military or bullied and just leaving on their own because they can't take it anymore. They're never going to have anything good to say about our military, and they're going to help breed a generation of people that don't want to be in our military. And what are we going to do as a nation if we don't have a capable military?
Roger Marsh here, jumping in once again to remind you that you are listening to Dr. James Dobson's Family Talk, and our guest today is retired United States Army General Jerry Boykin. He is sharing his high standards for code, duty, discipline, and honor, and giving us some inside the Pentagon national perspective and a few life lessons as well. General Boykin sheds light on current events and how to better our military culture and create a godly place where good men and women can serve with pride and conviction in our armed forces. Remember, today is Veterans Day, so please fly your flag and honor our U.S. veterans in every way you can. And now, let's return to General Boykin's powerful presentation on this Veterans Day edition of Family Talk.
How many of you remember Admiral Jeremiah Denton?
Admiral Denton represents everything good about America, a heroic patriot, a devoted husband, father, and a faithful Christian. On July 18, 1965, then Commander Denton was flying an A-6 intruder on a bombing run over the Vietnamese city of Than Hoi. His plane was shot down and he was captured by enemy forces. Admiral Denton was a Vietnam POW for nearly 8 years, 4 of which were spent in solitary confinement. In 1966, He was forced to appear in an interview before communist dignitaries with the purpose of having him admit to American atrocities. Before the interview, Denton was tortured and threatened with death if he did not answer correctly the questions posed. Defying his captors, Denton replied, "Whatever the position of my government is, I believe it, I support it, and I will support it as long as I live." During the questioning, Admiral Denton looked into the camera lens and blinked his eyes in Morse code, spelling out the message, "Torture." He provided naval intelligence with a first confirmation that American POWs in Vietnam were being tortured. On February 12, 1973, Denton was released from prison along with numerous other POWs. He was a spokesman for the first returning group of POWs.
Admiral Denton came back, ran for the Senate, and was a senator from Alabama. He was awarded the second highest award that the Navy gives for valor. It was a very heroic and courageous thing that he did there, but he had been well trained in the code of conduct. The code of conduct is simply what you're allowed and not allowed to do as a prisoner of war. He had been well schooled on this. Before the Navy put him into combat, and all of his buddies, his wingmates, they had been schooled on the code of conduct, what they were allowed to do and what they were not allowed to do. 2016, January, two Navy boats, patrol boats, traveling from Kuwait to Bahrain, allegedly went off course and were captured by the Iranian Navy. Remember that? The commander of the two boats was a U.S. Naval Academy graduate, just like Admiral Denton. Let's take a look at what that commander did and compare it to Admiral Denton.
It was a mistake. That was our fault, and we apologize for our mistake. It was a misunderstanding. We did not mean to go into Iranian territorial water.
The Iranian behavior was fantastic while we were here. We thank you very much for your hospitality and your assistance.
Did you get that? We want to thank them for their hospitality and their assistance. So the question then is, what's changed since the heroic actions of Admiral Jeremiah Denton? I'll tell you what the problem is. That whole crew was sent into combat unprepared because they spent their time doing this woke nonsense. They spent their time with critical race theory and all of the things that go with it. It's an injustice, and that's exactly what we do. I'm going to close this, but I'm going to tell you a story. I was the commander of the Delta Force during the events that you know as Black Hawk Down. And for those of you who have read a book, seen a movie, or heard anything about it, you know there was a Black Hawk helicopter that was shot down. And when that helicopter was shot down, I sent every person that I had to get the survivors out of that helicopter. The only thing I had left were the mechanics and the cooks and the communications people. That's all I had left. Everybody else had gone to that first crash, but 30 minutes later, a second helicopter was shot down, a second Black Hawk. And over that Black Hawk, when it went in, was another Black Hawk with two Delta Force snipers on there, Randy Shugart and Gary Gordon. And they called immediately and they said, "Sir, we're over the crash. They can't get out of their seats. I think their backs are broken. Put us in and we'll get them out." I said, "Look, I can't put you in there. I got no way to support you. I'm getting everybody collected up now that it can carry a rifle. And as soon as we're ready, I'll let them go." They call. I said, "Stay up there and keep shooting. Keep the Somalis off that crash. Just keep shooting." They called back in about 10 minutes and they said, "Sir, it's really bad. There's so many Somalis coming around here. Put us in." I said, I can't put you in. I can't put you in. Finally, they called back and they said, sir, we're the only chance. Please put us in. I said a quick prayer. I said, put them in. I said, you guys understand what you're asking for? They said, yes, sir. I said, put them in. They went in, got in low, low hover. They jumped out. They fought their way into the crash site of the other Black Hawk, and they got the crew out, got them all laid up next to the helicopter there where they had some protection, and then these two men went on the other side and just took up firing positions, and they just started hammering as the Somalis would try to come up on the helicopter there. And the one guy that survived this thing was a guy named Mike Durant. He just ran for Senate down in Alabama, didn't make it through the primary, but he's a great American. And he told us the story. He said, all of a sudden, Gary Gordon came back and said, is there any more ammo? We're just about out. And he said, behind the pilot's seat. And he went in and got some out of the behind the pilot's seat, and he threw some over to Gary Shugart, and they started firing again, boom, boom. And finally, Mike Durant told us, he said he heard Shugart yell out, Gordy, I'm hit. I'm hit bad, Gordy. And then his gun went silent. And then Mike Durant told us that in a few minutes he heard Gary Gordon yell out, Mike, I'm hit. And then his gun went silent. And then the next thing that Mike Durant saw was a wave of people that swept over the site, and they took him prisoner, and 11 days later we got him back. I stood in the White House as the President of the United States gave the families of these two men the Medals of Honor, and all I could think of was, what kind of men were these? What kind of men were these? But you know what it was? They were men that believed in something. They had a transcendent cause, and that transcendent cause was those guys on the ground down there. Because they took an oath. They had a creed. It's called the Ranger Creed. And it says, never will I leave a fallen comrade to fall into the hands of the enemy. Do you think today's military is going to produce those kinds of people with the kind of stuff that I've shown you tonight? It breaks my heart. It breaks my heart to see this happening to our military. Because we need a strong military. And we need men and women that have that transcendent cause, that are willing to say, put me in. I'm the only chance. God bless you all, and God bless America.
You've been listening to Dr. James Dobson's Family Talk. I'm Roger Marsh, and that was retired United States Army General Jerry Boykin with a powerful presentation entitled Let's Restore Our Military to Greatness. This was part two of this dynamic presentation, and both part one and part two are now available on our website at drjamesdobson.org/Family Talk. As always, thank you so much for your prayers and faithful financial support of our ministry. We cherish the friendship we share with you, and we are able to do so much as the result of your kindness, your prayers, your notes of encouragement, even your programming suggestions. By the way, you can donate to the JDFI securely online. Go to drjamesdobson.org for more information on how to do so. That's drjamesdobson.org, or give us a call. at 877-732-6825. When you contact us by phone, you'll be connected with a member of our constituent services team, and there will be someone there to speak with you, to listen to you, to answer your questions, even pray with and for you. Again, that toll-free number is available 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, and it's 877-732-6825. Well, that's it for today, Veterans Day 2022, this Friday, November 11th, and we hope that you have appreciated General Jerry Boykin's powerful talk on how we can restore our military to greatness. Now, let's make that happen. Let your voices be heard. I'm Roger Marsh, and from all of us here at the JDFI, thanks for listening, have a great weekend, and be sure to join us again on Monday for another edition of Dr. James Dobson's Family Talk.
This has been a presentation of the Dr. James Dobson Family Institute.